How would you use a Monopoly set to escape from a prison camp?
Mm. I could see how you might use a buckaroo.
Just fly up over the fence.
I mean, you'd probably just keep ending up on the barbed wire. Again, try it with the bucket.
Is it the old, covering up the hole with it?
Well,
like in Shawshank?
No, there was a man whose nickname was Clutty Hutton, who in Britain bought up lots of Monopoly boards and turned them into escape kits that he then set up through MI9 with these pretend charities.
Oh, so you'd get a get out of jail free card. That's a very good idea.
It was. No, what was brilliant was
the secret
that hidden in the Monopoly board were incredibly useful things.
A file.
Like a small dog, a tiny hat, and a little ship.
There would be real money interspersed with the Monopoly money. There would be maps on silk, because they obviously tried it on paper. It's too bulky and rustly, but on silk, on parachute silk, you get an enormous amount of detail and tiny. That's an example of his earlier work, putting a compass in a military tunic button. The Germans got wise to this. They'd unscrew them, eat the buttons, and they'd see it. So then they reversed the thread. So when the Germans unscrewed it, they in fact tightened the button. Then they got wise to that. So then he used razor blades, which were magnetised at one end, so that when they were attached to something metal, they would spin round with the G of Gillette would point north, which was very good, so they were well disguised.
They said, now, look, we put the normal thread on.
Yeah.
Old Kraut, he's unscrewing it. Then what we've done is we've put it the other way. So when he's unscrewing it, he's actually tightening it.
That's right.
Now we've gone a step further. We've done one here, you can't get the top off.
Isn't there a flaw in that, sir?
Don't complicate it. Don't complicate it, Perkins. No one's going to see this bloody compass, that's for sure. Give it a try. You won't get it off.
Oh, very good, sir.
In many ways, it's become what I call a button.
If I was the German camp commandant, I'd have made them all wear duffel coats.
If it was me, if I was in charge, I would have started shipping out giant Jengas.
Would you?
Well, then you just build them up. You know the Jengas you get in pub gardens?
Mm. Yes.
Massive ones, just hop over the fence.
Brilliant. If only you'd been in charge then.
Or snakes and ladders, but with actual ladders.
Yes.
And real snakes. Scare the Germans.
Scare the Germans.
Good British snakes who didn't like the look of a German soldier and would go up to them and go...
What about if they gave them toy tanks, but really big ones? And then they could just turn around and go, take this, Jerry!
Best place in the world to discover an entirely new species.
The National Geographic Channel.
Maybe.
They're at the forefront.
Do you think you might spot something on the edge of shot? The documentary makers have. See, they're going on about that monkey or whatever, but that's a totally new sort of caterpillar.
What about the Amazon rainforest, where they're discovering new things all the time? Kent.
Yes, that would do.
Kent
would do. Basically, your own garden. You may say, no, how? There won't be anything in my garden that hasn't been discovered. You would be amazed. In 1971, Jennifer Owen, a biologist, did a very long-term study of her ordinary garden in a suburban house in Leicester. She discovered 533 species of ichneumon wasp, just that family of parasitic wasps. 15 of these had never been recorded in Britain. 4 of them were completely new to science in a suburban garden. So in your garden, if you have a garden, there will be things. Gilbert White, the naturalist, said, nature is so full and so varied that if you want to find the place with the most variety, it's the place you most study. It almost doesn't matter. Just take a piece of land and look at it hard enough, you will see things that...
You're going rainforest, I'm sorry.
Yes, but you'd have to travel thousands of miles, you'd have to park there, you'd have to look, you'd have to, you know...
Park?
The point... Yes.
Everyone knows it's a nightmare parking.
I'm worried that my brain let me say that.
Where? Right?
The congestion charge alone would just make drives up the cost of research horrendous.
You taught to the great father of geography, Alexander von Humboldt, how to speak the Ature language 40 years after the last person who spoke it died.
A confidence trickster.
A parrot.
Yes!
That is good, though.
Brilliant. You are rocking. You are absolutely rocking. He was in Venezuela, Alexander von Humboldt, and he heard about this tribe that had been eaten by the Caribs, a cannibalistic tribe of the area, and they'd all gone, apparently, but someone said, no, there is a parrot who still is alive, that parrots can live quite a long time, and it knows...
How did it talk its way out of that?
It had 40 words in the language which von Humboldt wrote down and learned. But, of course, we can't know how accurate it was. It was with someone who spoke a related language, and they made guesses as to what the 40 Ature words might be.
Sort of like, who's a cheeky boy, then? Thing.
He would quite like that, because he was gay, Humboldt, funnily enough, as it happened.
Well, I find that kind of stereotyping rather offensive. So you're saying that all gay people are like cheeky boys?
No, he might have quite liked to say...
When are you going to let up with your relentless gay bashing?
How many words can a parrot learn, do you know?
182.
It's good and specific. There have been some 200. But the odd thing is why they speak at all. Why is it that they do mimic humans?
It's they have that little thing in the back of their throat that I have where they can go...
But the extraordinary thing is no parrot in the wild has ever been observed mimicking another bird or another animal.
So but there are birds in the wild.
There
that
are
mimic
birds that do.
Noises.
Yes, minor birds and other birds. Yeah. But parrots don't. In the wild, they just have their own screech and they're satisfied with that. They don't imitate other birds. They've never been observed to. And that is rather a shock, isn't it?
Do you have the answer to this? I hope
no,
so.
I don't.
You don't.
I'm sorry. No, it's a real question. So Humboldt apparently learned Ature. Doctor, doctor, I can't stop singing Auld Lang Syne. So the doctor says, I'll have to send you to the Burns unit.
Very good.
Ah. Now, what's wrong with that joke?
Is it absolutely terrible?
Yes, see. Now, any other thoughts? What is all
well, right? Of course it's not, because Burns Night is not on New Year's Eve, is it? It's on, when is
20th of January.
Yes.
Yes.
So, of course, you wouldn't be singing Auld Lang Syne on Burns Night. You'd be singing it on New Year's Eve. So
that's true.
You'd be waiting 3 weeks.
But most people think that Auld Lang Syne was written by Robbie Burns. And,
yeah. Auld Lang Syne wasn't even written by Burns.
That's right. Although a lot of members of the Burns Society believe he wrote it and say that it's nonsense he didn't, he himself said he didn't. He said it was a traditional song that he wrote down.
Really?
Yeah. Auld Lang Syne first comes up in 1724. We see it, and that was 35 years before Burns was born. It's a very popular song, though, in all kinds of places, especially in the Far East. In Japan, it's played daily to mark closing time in most large department stores. So, how did Burns sign himself? What was his name? What did he call himself?
Rabbi.
Not Rabbi, funnily.
Robin.
Robin he did, yes. Robin and Rab and Robert, but never Robbie or Rabbi, oddly enough. Oh. Although everyone calls him Rabbi or Robbie Burns. Yeah. And there you go. What does it mean, Auld Lang Syne?
Old...
Oh, I know what it means.
Long
remembrance?
Signs.
Yeah, kind of old long since. It means in the old days, long time ago. And how do the words go? Anyone who can give me the lyrics gets points.
We'll cack a couple kindness yet for the sake of all the
oh, yes, 4 points. Spot on. I went to the supermarket and all I wanted was a loaf of bread and some milk, and I came back with a small jar of truffle oil, a pot of organic anchovy.
I remember that day, that was brilliant.
and a flagon of fermented essence of Vietnamese sucking goat and a small curly-headed chap. When all I wanted was bread and milk, what was going on?
Early onset dementia, Stephen, which I think that's what it is.
It seems so.
Very clever with the way they put things in the aisles and they catch you out.
You end up with a Swiss roll you had no intention of buying.
Precisely. There is a huge science to the placing of products. There's a thing called a grün transfer. There was a man called Victor Grün who was generally considered the father of this whole business. Apparently, men buy things from higher up. They're also more likely to pay more. So everyday things that women are more likely to buy are at 3 to 4 feet, and the more expensive premium goods are higher up. The men will pluck those, say, yeah, that's good, that's the best, that's the most expensive one, that must be the best, because we're stupid like that. And the women will say, well, that's a good price, I'll get that one. It's called and the green transfer.
They play different music during, because you're more or less price sensitive at different times of the day. They play different music, it's more kind of sedate supermarket-y music during the afternoon, but by half an hour before the supermarket closes, they speed up the music in order to make you shop faster. And also the people go, beep, beep, bit quicker because the music develops a beat, so they actually
start playing the Crimson Tide music. People shot like their lives depend on it.
It seems we're all victim to this. I mean, I have to confess, I like to think of myself as an independently minded person, but I've gone into these shops wanting 4 things and come out with 20, and which of us hasn't?
But they make them look nice, but then you go home and enjoy them.
Oh, that's true.
You go home and go, this is just tar. No. Why the hell do they make me buy it? It is still a packet of biscuits. You go home and go, thank God I bought that nice packet of biscuits. I can have that now.
Yes, there is an element of that.
Yeah, I mean, like, we give out them as if they're being foisted upon us, like, and the guy in the mirror, they have bought our tar biscuits again. Take all good things off the shelves, only tar from here on.
Anyway, that's probably enough about that. Shops have a number of tricks up their sleeves in order to trick us into buying things we don't need. And when you've fallen for them, you're the victim of a Grün transfer.
How did Captain Schlitz, number 2, sink his own U-boat?
I'm assuming that the good captain was in the bath. This couldn't have happened in an actual...
No, it was a real...
What, you mean playing with a toy U-boat?
And it was with a
real
2.
U-boat. No. Oh, I see, number 2 in that sense is what you think.
Yes.
Not even yes, number 1, carry on, number 1.
He might have blocked the loo and caused some sort of terrible backup.
Affected the ballast.
Imagine how the lavatory on a submarine works.
Sorry, about a bit of a clip. Yeah. Ruthless competitor. it's something to do with the flush on the toilet.
How does that work, do you imagine, when you're underwater?
It's sucked in out, but it let water in.
Well... The point is that obviously the lavatorial arrangements of a boat that's submersible are very complex because you can't just flush the water out in the way you can from an aeroplane or a train. Mm. And you had to have special training to operate the flush.
Or you shoot a sailor out of the torpedo tube, tied to a rope, he relieves himself and you pull him back in.
Well, it seems that what happened was Captain Schlitt in his U-boat, U-1206. This is April the 14th, 1945, so just before the end of the war.
Oh, how annoying.
Very annoying for him. And he has a poo. And he claims that the loo was faulty and didn't work properly.
Yeah,
the
clue, as they would say,
the clue was gebrochen. It was not working. But there is a theory that, in fact, he'd just done a rather monster and unpleasant poo and was too embarrassed to ask the sailor who was responsible for the doing of the flushing to come in because there was a bit of a...
Yeah.
And and so he did it himself and got it in the wrong order and he filled the place with sewage and water. But more importantly...
I just left it.
Yeah, had it...
As you would in a hotel.
That was like that when I went in.
Yeah.
It was,
don't go in that one, my God.
So as he climbed out of the tower of the submarine and
they're underwater. That's the point.
This all happened. Did they
underwater,
sink?
Underwater. That's perish? Well. What happened? You see, is there was a leak of this water. The water came in, and it leaked into what powered those U-boats?
Diesel.
Well, they had a battery. A huge acid battery. And when the seawater hits the battery, it creates chlorine gas, chlorine gas. And so they had to rise up to the surface to vent. And they were spotted and blown out of the water. So just because he
It's very unfair to shoot a man with his trousers right down.
It is a bit. But it is the only known case.
This doesn't count.
Well, Captain Karlov Schlitz sank his own U-boat using nothing more deadly than its own navigation.
Aristotle, as I'm sure you all know,
thought that heavier objects fell faster than lighter objects. And it seems an intuitive and correct idea, but Galileo worked out that they didn't, and how did he do that?
Wait for it! He dropped 2 cannonballs off the Leaning Tower of Pisa.
Ah, well, did he?
I'm sorry about that, but
the reality is that he worked out that this was the case from his head. He then did some experiments with ramps and things that proved it to be true.
What's heavier, a ton of gold or a ton of feathers?
Exactly that kind of thing, if you like. But what he's saying is that, what's that? Half a ton... he's saying half a ton of coal... What Galileo
like
said...
like a sort of Elton John party request or something. Yeah.
Of course, the answer is that one of them is heavier, isn't there? Because gold is measured in troy weight rather than avoirdupois, and they're different. So a ton of gold is different to a ton of feathers. Sorry. I believe. I'm sorry. But what Galileo said was that half a ton of coal falls at the same speed as a ton of coal. That's the point. Falls at the same speed. You know, if you let go at the same time, they'll both hit the ground at the same time.
How can you get a ton of coal up in the air?
Well, indeed. Galileo's reasoning was thusly wise. He said that if you had a heavy object, if you believed Aristotle, yeah, it falls fast and the lighter one slow. So suppose you attach the light one to the heavy one. Well, the heavy one falls faster than the light one, so it would make the light one fall faster. Or the light one would hold the heavy one up because it's going slower. By attaching them together, you would make it go both faster and slower. And that's obviously impossible. The only explanation is that they both travel at the same speed. And he then proved it. And on Apollo 15, Scott, the astronaut, thought he'd try and see if Galileo was right. And we have a clip of him doing it. It's rather wonderful.
And I'll drop the two of them here, and hopefully they'll hit the ground at the same time. How about that?
How about that?
Which proves that Mr. Galileo was correct in his findings.
Isn't that cool? Astronaut David Scott proving Galileo right with a hammer and a feather. But Galileo established it by the power of his own thought. How many cricket pitches are there in Kansas?
One big one.
There's certainly it's a big square shape, but not a cricket pitch shape, Kansas.
It's to do with the measurement of corn, isn't it? It's to do with the measurement... It's nothing to do with the measurement
of
corn.
No, you're on exactly the right lines. Americans, how do they measure? Do they use the metric system or do they use a version of our imperial system?
They use yards and feet and miles and...
Yes, things. And the length of a cricket pitch, which is...
22 yards.
22 yards, and it's called a chain.
OK.
And when America was being measured out, they used these ancient English measurements. A chain, as I say, is 22 yards. There are 10 chains to a word that's still used in sport.
Furlong?
A furlong. Brilliant. Oh, points. 7 points. 80 chains to a...
Mile.
Yes. Excellent. Would you do well here? And an acre is 10 square chains. That's where an acre is derived. Right. OK. And this man, Gunter's chain, he actually had a chain that he used, like that, to measure out the land. So the whole of the northern Midwestern states were initially into blocks of 24 miles by 24, and within that subdivided into 20 chains by 20 chains, known as 40s, because that would be 40 acres. You may remember in The Grapes of Wrath, the Steinbeck novel, that the farmstead is the smallest type of farm, which is known as a 40.
I know a thing about the 40.
Oh, yes.
The 40 acres.
Yeah.
Did they not, when they had the emancipation of the slaves, were they not each entitled to a 40?
Yes. That was indeed.
And a mule, which is why Spike Lee called his company 40 acres and a mule. Yes. That's the thing I know about the 40.
7 points again. It's just the seven times table.
And is the country still divided by the Willie Nelson line?
Well, yes. You can see them there. This is from the air. And because Kansas, which is one of the most rectangular shapes of any of the states, almost perfectly so, you can actually calculate how many it is, and it's 3,474,386,388 cricket pitches would fit in there, in fact.
That's quite different to the answer I had.
How many men have been president of the United States?
Oh, it's 46 or something.
Well, shall we ask the great man himself? Shall we ask the current president?
Is he here?
Is he here tonight? Ladies and gentlemen.
What a waste of a guest. I'm glad we've given up my seat. I think he's sat in the audience for this one.
Here he is, the president, but which number, of the United States. He's here to tell us.
I thank President Bush for his service to our nation. As well as the generosity and cooperation he has shown throughout this transition. 44 Americans have now taken the presidential oath.
He's wrong.
He's wrong. He made a mistake.
He's only been on once and he's wrong already.
He is currently known as the 44th, just as Bush was known as the 43rd, but they aren't. Bush was the 42nd and he is the 43rd.
Oh.
Do you know why this is?
One of them was invisible.
Is there someone who was president for a bit and then stopped being president, someone else was president and came back?
There was one non-consecutive president. Right. It was the 22nd and the 24th.
Why did they count him as two? That doesn't make any sense. Yet they count Clinton as one.
Yeah, because his terms are consecutive. Terms. This one was the 22nd, then Benjamin Harrison was president, and then he was the 24th. This was Grover Cleveland.
I think if I was doing that, if I was setting that system up, I would have gone for the number of different men. Right? Yes. I would say, you know, that you get a new number if you're a different man.
Person, exactly.
Not if there was a gap.
No, I know, but there's only ever been one gap, and for some reason they didn't do that. So when he took his second oath, he was called the 24th president, although he was the same man who'd been the 22nd.
Well, he was actually Stalin.
He was. He does look a bit like that. Yeah.
So not only did he rule Russia, kill millions of people, he was two presidents of the United States.
It's a weird system,
isn't
it?
That's a CV.
It's quite a bombshell.
Now we know what he was doing in between presidents.
Yeah, exactly. Barack Obama is, in fact, the 43rd person to become president of the United States because Grover Cleveland held the position twice with a four-year break in between, making him the 22nd and the 24th president of the United States. How much of the moon can you see from the Earth?
Well, you can see one side of it.
Yes. There is this strange thing called libration, which is it's like vibration beginning with an L. It's a thing that was noted by quite a few of the early astronomers.
If that's an acceptable way of defining a word, what? Libration. It's just like vibration, but beginning with an L.
Just so you can picture it in your heads, is that bad?
I was with you already, just with libration.
I thought you might have heard it as libation or something like that, that's all.
what does it mean?
Well, I was about to tell you, and then somebody came and said... I'll tell you. You get this kind of jiggling effect. Basically, what it comes down to is you can see about 59% of the surface
of the
moon from Earth. Obviously, when it's a new moon or whatever, then you see it's a lot less. But you can see 59% of the surface rather than...
How upset are the Germans about the 1966 World Cup?
Well, very, I would say. They would be, if they surely, I would have thought, a proud nation like the Germans.
They were upset at the time, but I said, how upset are they? They barely remember it. If you asked every German who won the World Cup in 1966...
They're pretending.
Because we care about it, they don't. They care about their scores against Holland. That's their big thing. They really, honestly, if you ask the average German, they're just... 66. They really don't know. Oh, did you? Well done. You know,
international.
For us, it was like everything. Wow, we won. But they, in 1974, beat the Dutch, and that to them was the one they really, really care about.
But they surely, the Dutch have never provided great deal of opposition to them. Generally, in history, they've just walked into Holland whenever they fancied it.
Oh, in that sense.
Well, any time they want, they just go into Holland, which is just like spin the windmill. I haven't mentioned it yet. I was talking about the great Geschmertsflip in 1762, where they just walked into Holland, but they can just enter. I'll mention the War of Holland. You have to. Surely they're denying their true rivalry, which will be with us.
They're
in denial.
We may think that, but it's up to them to decide. I mean, you can't force a German to care about whether they beat us or not.
Well, they bloody well should!
Yes. I'm sure you're very upset by it, but, I mean, they just don't care that much. And there are other things like the sun lounge hogging with the towel.
Yeah.
Is that something you've actually experienced?
Yeah.
There's some picture of it.
These are some of Alan's holiday photos.
It turns out that a German lawyer called Ralph Hooker actually did a study and he confirms that we think it. But Germans are blissfully unaware of their reputation in this case.
No,
but
really?
A study by Halifax...
Well, I think they don't care is the right description of it.
They just don't... They don't know that's what we think of them.
They
but Halifax Travel
Insurance... just common sense to go down before breakfast, basically at dawn.
It turns out...
take all the beds around the pool.
That Halifax Travel Insurance in 2009 confirmed with a study that Germans are the most likely to reserve sun lounges with towels. And which nation do you think is the second most likely to?
The Dutch?
The British.
The British. Yeah.
Very close.
We'll turn up
in
ten
fact.
Minutes later. Ah,
oh, exactly. While the French and Italians and Portuguese are having breakfast and not really
well, and also they're in their own countries.
Yeah, well, that's... that's true.
Enjoying the lovely food and weather.
That is highly... What happened at a snail's pace? Never mind snail mail. What happened to the snail telegram? Or telegraph?
That's not it, is it?
That's no. That's it. Amazing Frenchman called Benoit had a theory that when two snails, male and female, mated, right, that forever afterwards, they had a telepathic power. There's some
all right.
mating snails for you. And that no matter how far away they were, they could communicate thoughts to each other. So he raised money to develop this system where he had a sort of dish to which he glued, right, 24 snails, which he labelled A to Z, missing out, I think, Q and X, possibly. And then the mates of each one, he did the same to on another dish, and the other dish could go to New York. All you had to do was wibble the A, and the A in New York one would wibble because it had mated with the... And so you'd send your message by typing snails, and the person at the other end would watch the snails vibrate and read the message. But, as I say, the amazing thing is he found someone to invest in this.
Yeah. Yeah. And that, gentlemen, is how we broke the Enigma code.
Isn't it fantastic? It was called the Pasilalinic Sympathetic Compass, using escargotic vibration.
These snails are just disgusting. They are riding all over each other, were they? Stop it, get a room!
Technically, they have
got
a room.
Yeah. They carry their own room around with them. Yes, the that's sort of their thing.
Is it wrong to be aroused now? Because I
oh. Anyway, sadly, the Pasilalinic Sympathetic Compass, or snail telegraph, simply didn't work. What was quite interesting about the birth of Julius Caesar? Yes.
It was a wolf. Somebody with a wolf.
Sucked out by a wolf.
I think it's an unfortunate sort of illusion of Romulus and Remus there, not Julius Caesar.
Right.
Romulus and Remus were said to have been suckled by wolves.
Yes.
Caesarean section.
Oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear. Oh, dear, I'm afraid that's another cunningly laid trap you've fallen into, Mr. Bond.
It's... I felt that might happen, to be
honest. I know, yeah, I know. It's sort of inevitability.
There's something
inevitability.
About that that felt
no,
like...
The fact is that...
I'm a bit lemming-like, aren't I?
You're small and furry and attractive.
Stephen Wright said he was born by caesarean section. It doesn't really affect him, except when he goes into a room, he leaves by the window. Julius Caesar was born by caesarean
no,
section.
No, he was
well,
not.
Why, well, what does it mean, then? Why is it caesarean section?
It's a corruption
section?
Of the word cadere, meaning to cut. There was such a thing as of what we call caesarean section in Roman times, but the mother always died. The only way they knew how to do it would always kill the mother.
Slash
and Aurelia, who was Aurelia, who was Julius Caesar's mother, was known to have lived well into his adulthood, so he could not have been born by caesarean
So that's
section.
Not the answer.
How was he born?
How was he born?
We,
so
don't
know
we don't know anything particularly extraordinary about his features and birth. We just wanted Laughing Boy here to fall into the
trick
trap.
Question.
I'm afraid it worked. I'm sorry.
It was purely a trap.
I'm sorry about that.
They couldn't do the eyes, could they, the sculptors in them day?
No, they couldn't.
It's just rubbish.
No.
And they said, what do you think? And he went, that's...
They probably
didn't even try, don't they?
Covered them in,
though.
They used to paint them.
They were all painted.
Quite right.
Yeah. Do I get
points
for that?
Why wasn't that painted?
Same with English churches, which are all clearly painted.
No, and then, of course, the White Cliffs of Dover as well. That was all coloured in one point. Big jungle scene, the man of giraffes.
Well, a massive great mural all around the south coast.
All the different peoples of the world holding hands.
Yeah. All pointing at Westlife, drowning in the sea. Like, going, yay! Because they used to do public drownings. Why don't they do it for people on death row, drown them?
You could ask for your last meal to be coconuts and you could form a raft and...
Describe the rules on a pirate ship.
Rules?
Yeah. Well, what sort of rules would they have?
Obviously, they've got a captain.
Yes.
So he's in charge. So I imagine he gets most of the gold and whatever they find.
Well, oddly enough, now, they had two senior officers, the captain and the quartermaster. And the captain could be vetoed by the quartermaster on all matters except battle. except okay. rules of engagement when fighting. And they had strong laws. And the quartermaster was, he was about how much they divvied out, including he decided how much the captain got. The captain had no special quarters. He didn't have a, you know, wonderful room such as you imagine in movies. So it's not exactly hierarchical. It's kind of a rule of two, the quartermaster and the captain. Otherwise, it was more or less a democracy in a strange sort of way, but with strict rules. For example, in Captain Bartholomew Roberts' ship, the Fortune, and there was no gambling. It was like a boarding school. No smuggling girls into the dorm, no playing music on a Sunday, and lights out at 8 o'clock sharp in the evening.
It's rubbish being a pirate.
I know. Not quite what you imagine.
My dad, the captain. That's rubbish.
But you're going to smuggle these girls from anyway. Well,
that's true.
Do you rescue one from the sea? No.
When it came to women aboard, the articles of Captain George Lowther, who was a famous pirate of his day, said, "If at any time you meet with a prudent woman, that man that offers to meddle with her, without her consent, shall suffer present death." So meddling with a prudent woman without her consent got you death. So they really were very strict with each other.
So meddling was rape, really?
I think essentially we're talking
that
about rape.
Lost its meaning by the time Scooby-Doo came
exactly.
on.
Exactly. Why do pesky kids own medals?
Notorious gang rapists.
That's just terrible. I'm ashamed of you.
Why is the pirate voice similar to the farmer's voice? Why? Is there something... Arr! Get off my land!
There's one man responsible. Do you know who it is?
It'll be a film actor.
Yes.
Oh, OK.
Treasure Island.
He played in a great performance of Treasure Island. In fact, Tony Hancock, the great comedian, he first started out as an impersonator of this actor.
Lawton?
No, not quite as well known as Lawton. In his own day, he was very, very well known, but now less well known.
Anybody?
It was on QI before. We've mentioned on QI before.
Hang on a minute.
The chances of Alan remembering it are.
Someone in the front row saying, "You've done this."
This
was on Dave on Tuesday. New facts.
Yeah, well, it was Robert Newton anyway.
Robert Newton.
Thank you, yes.
Robert Newton
is the right answer, yeah, but it doesn't count because we've had it before.
David Prowse always almost did that, didn't he, to Darth Vader? He has a West Country accent, didn't he?
Yes,
and
he
famously thought that he was going to be used, didn't he?
Yes.
With his West Country accent, he got redone.
I am your father.
Jones.
Very upset. I'm your father, and I'm your brother as well.
See, I'll play her on a big tractor. Yeah. Trundling down the corridors of the Death Star, chewing a bit of straw.
Yeah. Darth.
Mr. Darth to you.
Mr. Darth. Anyway.
You know the skull and crossbone flag?
Yes.
Do they really have that? Because, I mean, that's really giving it away,
we definitely covered that in the last
series. Oh, really?
I must have missed Alan will tell you all about it.
Go on.
Jolly Roger.
Well, yeah, everyone knows it's called that. Is that a proposition? Maybe later, Alan.
It's been 10 years, Stephen, and I've finally come round to it. It's time for a Jolly Roger.
Trees made of?
Wood!
Is the right answer.
Yes,
well done. You see? And what is wood made of?
Carbon?
Yes. And where does the carbon come from?
The earth.
The earth?
Yeah.
No, you'd think most of what makes a tree was drawn up from the soil in nutrients.
It's the air, is it?
It's actually vast majority of everything that makes a tree comes from the air, yeah. Photosynthesis, which breaks down the air and leaves the carbon. And that's the carbon that makes a tree, so it is made of carbon. It's quite surprising. Now, until 2008, it was legal to smoke what I'm talking about in Dutch coffee shops, but now they've changed the law. So what is it? Yes.
Tobacco.
He's clever. He's right. No. We thought you might say cannabis, but you're too smart.
No, they don't mind you smoking that. They encourage it.
Yeah.
I went to Amsterdam when I was 19 years old, and I don't do drugs, and I'd never done drugs. And I sat in this cafe, and everyone was smoking. And genuinely, I said, no, no, I'm not going to touch that. I'll just have a piece of cake. And I ate his cake, and then someone said, you know what?
It's a hash brownie.
But I thought that was the same way as you have, like, brandy and trifle or something. I thought, it's not going to get you drunk. It's just a little jokey thing they say. So I had one. I said, it had no effect. I'll have another one. So I ate another one, and then at 2 o'clock in the morning, I accused the taxi driver of trying to kill me.
No, you're right. The point is, it leads to rather bizarre situations. If you mixed your cannabis with tobacco in a coffee shop, you would be fined.
Mm. Well, that's what they used to sell.
So you can only have pure...
mixed or...
Not since July 2008. Now you have to smoke your cannabis as pure cannabis in grass or hashish form, I suppose.
So you can't get passive smoking from pure...
No, it's fantastically carcinogenic. It's much more carcinogenic than tobacco.
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh, dear.
It's seven times more or something.
Oh, shush, really?
So here it is.
Well...
Three joints, that's 20 fags.
Oh, my goodness. But in the street, if you were to smoke... You could smoke tobacco in the street, but if you were to mix it with cannabis, you'd be breaking the law by doing that.
Yeah, so it's a very complicated system. You don't know whether to go indoors or out.
But magic mushrooms.
Magic mushrooms.
Or a version of magic mushrooms, since you're talking about drugs. The fly agaric, which is that sort of... Like the mushroom you get in a fairy tale. You'd see
toasty, like a big cheese toasty.
Sitting on it, sort of red with white spots on it.
Yeah.
The fly agaric in Siberia was eaten by the reindeer. And so the reindeer would eat this fly agaric and they'd bounce around.
Off their face.
And that is where they reckon the legend of flying reindeer came from.
Oh!
For your Christmas edition.
That's a Christmassy story. Thank you, David.
The drug-addled reindeer. Old Siberia.
Because it's highly toxic to humans, so they would collect the reindeer urine and drink it and get a secondary...
Buzz.
Hit.
Yeah.
Oh, buzz. That's
And then you could drink the wee of the man that drunk it. Just a mild sort of... nice feeling.
Yeah.
Eventually, it would come down to a tiny little... Just a cube. A cube, isn't it? And then pop it in your drink. And it'd be like a little sort of Pro Plus.
Colour was Frankenstein. Yes.
Green.
Oh! Frankenstein was a baron in a novel who was a scientist who made a monster.
Yes, I know. Right. And the monster's name?
The monster's name.
The monster's actual name in the book. He does have a name.
Go on, tell us.
Adam.
Adam, of course he's called Adam, because he's like the first man he's made. Yeah. So, yes, what colour, obviously, was Frankenstein's monster?
Oh,
yep.
Green. Purple.
It's been a grey colour, but that's because I only ever saw him in black and white.
No.
I don't really know what
she didn't write a black and white book, except in the sense the print was black and the paper was white, but she used coloured words, and she did describe Mary Shelley, who wrote the novel, of course, in 1818.
Dawn is yellow.
Lavender. Yellow is the answer. His yellow skin scarcely covered the work of muscles and arteries beneath.
Oh.
His hair was of a lustrous black and flowing, his teeth of a pearly whiteness.
When she says it's scarcely covered, does she mean there were gaps?
Yeah, because he was like a dead body had been brought back
Bits
to life.
Bits of them.
So it was like, Like the mummy. You remember when the mummy gets, in the movie, gets...
Bits come off. Imhotep.
Imhotep. Imhotep. Yeah, well, Frankenstein's monster was, in fact, yellow in the book, anyway. So tell me, what good did the Great Fire of London do?
Be tender. I'm risking it here, but I don't care. Wiped out the plague.
Oh, dear. It was taught in school, so you've got every reason to think it, but it's just simply not true. There's no evidence whatsoever. Apart from anything else, the plague was already over.
Well, yeah, but it wiped out the conditions in which it could have come back.
Not really, because the plague was mostly in the suburbs, not in the city. The city was not the place that was most affected by the plague, but it was the place that was destroyed by the fire. By the time September 1666 happened, which was the fire, there were very few deaths. It had gone down to... It had almost ended. No-one quite knows why it ended, but it certainly wasn't the fire.
Did it make it easier for them to knock down a load of places that they had their eye on?
Essentially, that's the point. It gave the chance to Christopher Wren to get some church building done, especially St Paul's, of course.
They had lots of grandiose plans about turning London into a grid or a spiral or that, and then they kind of thought about it for ages and then went... Put it back as it was.
Yes.
All squiggly lines and weird corners, please.
Yeah, which we have. It is one of the
nice. Yeah, but I think Christopher M was a bit depressed about it.
Yeah. Well, the best thing about the Great Fire of London was that it got Wren an opportunity to build... What's the toughest way, though, to become a mummy?
Well...
I'll take it.
Here's Jimmy!
Reverse cowgirl?
Now, they understand that, and you're going to have to explain it to me. What is your
reverse
cowgirl? I'm going to need a volunteer from the audience.
If you're having sex with me...
Yeah.
Or Mel.
Or Mel. Yeah. Say you're having sex with Mel, yeah. And you're... lying down,
yes,
on your back,
yeah,
and Mel is... I can't use her name in that stuff.
No.
She's Jordan. Sitting on top of you but looking away. Reverse cowgirl.
Oh.
I find they're much happier without looking away from me.
That, however...
Especially if you see out the window, it's like a budgie.
She could be reading a book or watching telly. She could do what she likes.
She could see the telly or outdoors. She don't mind.
That's wonderful.
Yeah. It's catch-up time for women,
so
basically.
So she's doing Sudoku or whatever?
Yes, whatever you need to do, you just...
Yes, you're thinking of making babies, aren't you? That sort of mummy, I realise now, as well. yeah. Can you turn yourself into a mummy? That's the point.
Is probably.
Yeah, you could, couldn't you?
Probably wrap yourself up in...
Mummify yourself.
Well, haven't you got to take your liver out through your nose? That's what they used to do, isn't it? They used to take the organs out through the... mouth and nose.
Well, the brain they would take out through the nose. They'd agitate it with hooks so that it turned into a liquid mush and then...
Oh!
Pour... Yeah, I know.
Worse than being buried alive?
and then after that, they would kill them.
Yeah, wow. But the Soku Shinbutsu were members of an obscure Buddhist sect who, in Japan, used to practice the rather macabre idea of self-mummification. This is what they do. It's quite complicated. It's really interesting. See if you do this. For 1,000 days, right, a priest would eat nuts and seeds while taking part in vigorous physical activity so that he had no body fat. He'd then only eat bark and roots for another 1,000 days and then drink a poisonous tea made from the sap of the urushi tree that caused him to vomit and lose bodily fluids. Then he would lock himself into a tiny stone tomb with an air tube and a bell, and he'd sit in the lotus position, and every day he'd ring his bell to show that he was alive. And when the bell stopped, the tube was removed and the tomb was sealed, and then other monks in the temple waited for another 1,000 days and then opened the tomb, and if the monk had succeeded in preserving his body in his death, he would be considered to have achieved the state of a truly enlightened Buddha.
Who made that game?
Buddhists.
You know, you...
it's a terrible photo of him. If I was going to get all that trouble, I'd have a decent photo taken of me.
I like this, because, I mean, a lot of people get away with thinking that Buddha is like the sane religion. Buddhas, you know, Buddhists are, you know, normal and decent, but even Buddhism has weirdery beyond belief, really, I'm afraid.
Yeah. They don't do it like that anymore, obviously, do they?
No, it's now an illegal form of suicide.
They have a webcam now, don't they?
As a form of suicide, though, I think that should be promoted because, you know, if you jump off something high and land, it's all over very quickly. You've not been able to think it through. With that, you can sort of change your mind. You go, do you know what? I fancy a drink. After about 900 days, you go, oh, pizza wouldn't go amiss.
If you open it after 1,000 days and he hasn't turned into a mummy, would you say, I told you he had a Twix?
Anyway, yes, members of an obscure Buddhist sect in Japan went through an extremely rigorous process of self-mummification until the practice was stopped in the 19th century.
What kind of music do spiders like?
Well, I reckon they got 8 legs. They'd appreciate a one-man band. Chicka-chicka-ching, dum-dum. No, they'd kind of appreciate that all-round entertainer.
Etc.
Kylie Minogue.
What is that?
Spinning Around.
Oh, spinning around, very good. You could have said Andrew Webber, I suppose.
Yeah. Ah, actually, on a similar note, might it be Cliff Richards? Because
Richards?
His real name, Cliff Richard, rather, I beg your pardon. Webb.
It's his real name.
Marty Webb. Webb.
Marty Webb. It's all just, isn't it?
But I don't think spiders are that into puns. I think they like flies, stuff like that. Jeez. I'll tell you an interesting fact about spiders. The huntsman spider, which, well, one a little fact everyone knows, doesn't actually build a web, is the only spider with lungs.
Oh, I like that.
So you can get it a birthday cake with a candle on.
Yeah.
That's a sweet thing to think of. What a nice way of thinking. What do spiders do to flies?
They wrap them up in web, like in Lord of the Rings.
Yeah,
like and silk.
And then take them off, wait till they've toughened up a bit, and then they eat them.
Well, that's the other thing, they don't eat them, they drink them.
They drink them.
Because they squirt them with acid that dissolves them into a sort of
flies,
liquid.
When they land on your food, they immediately vomit on it.
Mm.
and then they tread about on it like that, get it all mushy, and then they digest that.
That's quite rude, isn't it?
It is.
They listen with their feet. They're 8 feet.
Here you coming.
And they have a penis on their head.
Oh.
That's on the end of a little feeler. That's where their mating organ is, the males.
They're just a mess.
Exactly. They're all dickheads. they have 8 eyes as well, most of them.
Spiders have eight eyes and 8 legs.
Yes. Yeah. Well, the answer to this question is it does seem to be classical music because they did an experiment and they found that University of Ohio in this instance is they or are they?
The University of all else better.
Ah, well, no.
Formerly the Polytechnic of all else. Yeah.
Domestic spiders were subjected to Bach, techno, I believe, is some kind of modern music, and rap. For techno and rap, they built their webs as far away from the speakers as possible. And for classical music, close to it. Someone very close to me told me about a music called Tesco. Do you know about that?
No.
It's a blend of disco and techno. Sweet. And it's Tesco. And they have Tesco evenings in certain nightclubs.
Really?
It's a type of modern young person's dance music, like two-step UK garage, for example, which is my particular favourite.
These would be nightclubs right on the edge of town.
On the edge of town.
Plenty of parking.
What tools do you need for do-nothing gardening?
No tools.
You think? It's also called natural gardening or natural farming. It's an Eastern version of our organic farming that has actually spread around the world.
You sort of have to dig with your hands or persuade other animals to do the gardening for you.
Yes, persuade other animals.
So you sort of persuade that a fox who doesn't want a sort of den, but a rockery.
Well, in the case of Paddy
Field... get some fish in and they desperately try and dig a pond before they die.
Well, fish is right. Well, in Paddy Fields, as I say, it started in the East, they use ducks instead of herbicide. They eat the weeds. The throttly weeds. Things that kill the rice, and they use carp as well to help purify and keep the water in the paddy fields good. What travels from Land's End to John O'Groats every year at about 1/3 of a mile per hour, but it slows down a bit on hills?
Does it specifically go from there to there, or is it just a north-south?
It actually goes from the south to the north, but it includes going from Land's End.
Is there a sort of tectonic...
No,
wave or
it's
something.
Not a tectonic
weird.
Wave.
I don't know if they exist. I just made that up.
No, no, it's something sort of slightly more abstract. It's a phenomenon rather which you were sort of getting.
Is it dress sense? If we're talking about moving from the south to the north.
Oh,
the Gulf Stream or something? Does it sort of? Is it a windy thing?
Seasonal. It is a season.
Spring
is the answer. Spring. Takes 8 weeks to get from the very south coast all the way up to the very north and up to the Orkneys.
Well, what's the definition of spring?
Well, there is a phenotype analysis you can do of particular common plants blooming. Anyone who lives, say, in the Midlands and occasionally goes to London will say, oh, my God, they've already got their daffodils out, or we haven't yet. Or they'll go north and say, oh, they haven't got their tulips yet. And it's very noticeable.
That's sort of bastard.
Yeah?
when the weatherman's on Radio 4 and he goes, and you might like to make note that it's the first day of spring today. And no, it's not! I think you're feigned. I'm still freezing here.
8 miles a day it does, spring. Is that what we're saying?
I'm saying it takes about 8 weeks to get from John O'Groats, and someone's calculated that as being about 1/3 of a mile per hour.
You could walk and just beat spring.
Yeah.
You could. It's a weird thought. That's very weird, isn't it?
If you timed it with a daffodil, you could, and walked at exactly the right speed,
then
you could
open
go...
His...
Oh,
God. And you'd be rather beautiful.
I'm in touch with my feminine side.
You're responding to your handwriting beautifully. Well, it's the phenological observations, as they call them, of the various different things that trigger spring. It's a rather wonderful thought, isn't it? Spring moving up like that. What travels the wrong way along a motorway at 12 miles per hour? Yes, baby.
There's an elderly man in a Morris Minor.
No, it's one of those motorised wheelchairs. Oh!
For the same thing. Well, no, this is an effect we might all have experienced on motorways, and a deeply unpleasant one and yet a perplexing one.
There was a wonderful New York cartoon where it showed a huge traffic jam and a man looking in a puzzled way at a sign that said, traffic jam clears inexplicably 3 miles ahead.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's the phenomenon we're looking at. If you drive, you know that sometimes you can be in this terrible traffic jam and then it will magically clear. Yeah. No cones, no police, there's never not been anything wrong, and you think, well, what was that about? And there's a science which is like fluid dynamics, but they use things called kinematic wave equations. And what happens is a car will suddenly brake, and the car behind it will brake, and the car behind it will brake, and so on and so on. And so it sends a ripple effect back through the traffic. Oh, yeah. And the one ahead can start off again quite cheerfully, saying, oh, it was only a pigeon diving at my windscreen. But the other ones are still slowing down, and they continue to, going backwards. There you see them backing up. And they continue to back up for quite long distances. While the ones ahead are free. But they've discovered that pulse backwards of braking travels on average about 12 miles an hour and can cause big
presumably
jams.
Presumably, you get the same effect when there's a police car in the slow lane doing 60.
Oh, yes. So annoying. Everyone inch past it. Yeah. If I just... I bet police love that.
Do you ever give them
oh,
look,
he's going 71, shall we? Shall we? But, of course, we know nothing of traffic jams in this country. Which country is the absolute heroic epicenter of the traffic jams, of all traffic jams?
I would think India.
No, it's China. Oh, China has epic, I mean, epic traffic jams. They had one in 2010 that was over 80 miles long, and it moved on average less than a kilometre a day. I'm not kidding you. That's how bad it was. And they're so bad regularly that they now have quite profitable services where you call up this service and they arrive on a motorbike, two people on a motorbike, one gets in and takes your place in the traffic jam and you get on the back and the other one drives you through the traffic. But can you imagine?
Do people bring you things, like when you get a phone, a pizza and that?
Probably. They're an enterprising people, Chinese, I should imagine so.
But it would be very difficult, I suppose, if you bought the pizza on the motorbike, you'd be all right. But it'd be quite frustrating to order the pizza. You know, we're at the light, so we're 4 days away. I was quite impressed. I went to Las Vegas last year, and they have those billboard trucks that say they can deliver a hooker to your room in 25 minutes. but the pizza still takes half an hour. So what I've worked out is that you could, if you had the resources, get the hooker to pick up the pizza for you.
Absolutely brilliant. What's the most repeated TV show of all time?
Top Gear.
It is.
You do get a lot
There's
of Top
not
Gear.
A time of day when it is not possible to watch Top Gear. It's true. It is on, and it's always a different one.
Ah, but this one is one programme.
One show that's the
one most... show is the most repeated show.
It's a German show.
It's a British comedian. Two British comedians.
The Duchess.
Sorry?
It's called The Duchess or something like that.
I think you know what I'm referring to,
The waiter or lady somebody. It's a British comic being a waiter to a posh.
It's called Dinner for One.
That's right.
And it's shown on every channel in Germany on December the 31st every year and has been since 1972.
Oh, and I know who's in it as well.
Yes.
Freddie Frinton.
Freddie Frinton, you're right, plays a butler who has to serve a Christmas dinner for his mistress, played by Mae Ward, who's rather mad and old, and pretend that there are other people there, and he pours out drinks for them and gets drunk himself. You can see a bit of it. Here you are. It's broad humour, but it was...
it's all very well in its own way, but what's going on with it every single channel, every single year?
It's become a cult. It's unavoidable in Germany. They have parties for it. It's just a tradition. It was a sketch done in 1920. They used to do it, you know, on the halls and all around the other places like that. And a German TV presenter saw it in 1963 and thought it was amusing and said, come and do it on German television. So they did it on German television once. Then they did it again to record it. In 1972, they showed it, and they've showed it ever since. And it's become so popular. I think, to give the Germans their credit, they laugh as much ironically at it as we would if we saw it. It's just one of those things that happens to have become an extraordinary tradition.
I'm quite glad we've got the Great Escape over here.
That's our tradition. If you, you might exactly
not on every channel.
Not on every channel, I agree. It is pretty extreme. It's almost impossible to avoid Dinner for One with Freddie Frinton. Just how great were the great train robbers?
Well, they're not that great because they got caught.
Well, yeah. I mean, they got so caught. They got caught almost immediately.
Yeah.
And they got caught in very stupid ways. Do you know how they were caught? They went to this farm and played Monopoly using the stolen money as their Monopoly money. And then they cleared out and left their fingerprints over everything, over all the Monopoly set. And they were all, you know, they all had form. They were all, you know, known blaggers. So they were just rounded up, all 12 of the gang of 15. One was acquitted, two were never caught. They were pretty inept, is the answer, basically. Who's the most famous of the great train robbers, would you say?
Ronnie Biggs.
Ronnie also said Ronnie Biggs, yeah. And what was his role? Was he the mastermind? Is that why he's the best known?
No.
No, he was such a small peg in the whole thing.
Was he the driver?
No, he wasn't even that. He was inside. He was doing a stretch for taking and driving away. And the mastermind of the entire event met him and said, I'm planning this blag.
I'm planning a game of Monopoly.
Yeah, planning a game of Monopoly.
He's just got to kick something up on the way.
Yes,
it's
exactly.
My set, I've lost all the fake money. And the only way of replacing it I can think of...
I rang Waddington's, they didn't want to know. Get a new set, they said. Don't be ridiculous, I said.
Anyway, the mastermind was called Bruce Reynolds. And he said, if you can find me someone who can drive a train, a diesel train, I will cut you in on a big job that's going down.
You can find... I mean, it's not, that's like the, I mean, that's not like someone who can sort of melt diamonds with their eyes. Someone who can drive a diesel... Apparently they exist somewhere.
But the amazing thing, David Mitchell, is... that Biggs found this guy whose nickname was Old Pete or Stan Agate. No one knows who he was because he was the one who was never caught.
Oh, was that Old Pete the train driver? And, I know.
So his job... Right,
after Casey Jones had turned him down.
For this, for being found, Ronnie Biggs got a share worth 147,000, which in today's money is 1.6 million. And all he had to do, Ronnie Biggs, was get this guy, Old Pete, to the scene. But this Old Pete got to the train and said, oh, I don't know how to drive that. Well, Biggs still got his share, but the Old Pete was useless. He couldn't drive the train. He'd been lying all the time.
I like the idea that Old Pete's like those actors who put on their CV, yes, I can horse ride. Yes, I can drive a train. I speak Mandarin, too. Train through China, no problem at all.
That's how he found him. He went through Spotlight. And the other, apparently, he was very well reviewed. Yes. Much to do about nothing.
And he's trained in modern dance. That could come in handy. Well, the great train robbers weren't particularly great. Most of them were caught because they left fingerprints on the Monopoly set at the safe house. Which was the first animal to be cloned?
It's not
Dolly the sheep, then.
No, you're right. It isn't Dolly. You've all been so good at avoiding my little honey traps. No.
But I thought it was Dolly the sheep. But it's not.
Not the first animal, no. We have to go back to the 1880s for the first cloning.
Really?
Yeah. It was a sea creature, actually.
An octopus or something?
No, it was a sea urchin. There's one. This was in a German called Driesch, who did it in 1885. But in 1902, another German, Hans Spemann, cloned a salamander. And he used a rudimentary noose, right, to separate the cells of the embryo. And the noose was made of the hair of a human baby. And he used it as like a little lasso to separate. Isn't that marvellous?
That is fiddly work.
It is very fiddly work, I've got to say.
There must have been lots of times where he's going, I'm done, done! Okay. Could I please have another baby's hair?
Back to the baby.
All the people trying...
One guinea, madam.
trying to keep him calm. Would you like another... No, I don't want another coffee. I don't want...
go. Do you want me to have a go?
No, I don't.
Right. But Dolly was in 1996. Dolly the sheep is the one that you cleverly avoided. But why Dolly? Why called Dolly? Do you know?
It was named after Dolly Parton because a cell came from the mammary glands.
Correctly correcting. Yeah. Well done, sir. Excellent. Only points.
think there was a point where they go, we can just get another sheep and say, yeah, there it is, it's genetically identical, that one. There, those two sheep look similar. Well, that's because they're genetically identical.
Well, oddly enough, things can be genetically identical and rather surprising because the first cat to be cloned was called Rainbow and her clone was known as CC. And there. You say, now, how can that...
Ah, well, they did, just didn't... They didn't put the effort in,
Well,
they trawl the pet shop through that little, faker. They could have... they could have at least sent the guy who they sent to get the other kitten with a photo of the not just get any cat.
Yes. The little kitten is called CC. Points if you can guess what that stands for.
Cat clone.
Wittier. What sort of wittier? Say... Points to the audience. Copycat, you see. Very good, yeah. The operation was known as Operation Copycat, obviously. It's part of a larger project to clone a dog, which was... Well, it was called Missy, the Missiplicity, named after a dog named Missy. And the world's first cloned dog from Korea is called Snappy.
And they ate it.
Of course. Anyway, the point is, the first animal to be cloned was the sea urchin way back in 1885. Since then, many other animals have, of course, been given the treatment, including the first cloned cats, which look nothing like each other. What is gothic about the Goths? Yes.
The Goths were an ancient German tribe, I think, who wore crushed velvet and very, very thin drainpipe trousers and spat in shopping centres. And Goths have carried on that tradition to this day.
A rampaging army of horny-headed warriors.
Yes, and actually, you should have some points because, oddly enough, people think of Goths as German, but they were originally Scandinavian. And you look Scandinavian. Well, you know, from that
Glaswegian area. Scandinavian.
Norwegian Scandinavians.
They sound dangerous.
They came from Scandinavia. And they defeated the Vandals, who were a group of Germans, which is where we get our word
Vandal
from.
Hang around bus shelters.
Yeah, exactly. And so I think you are, oddly enough, the most Gothic of the Goths, because the point is Gothic has been used to mean all kinds of things. What kind of things can you think of that are applied to Gothic?
Cathedrals.
Cathedrals? Why are they called Gothic?
Well, is it anything that isn't classic?
Yes, it was an insult, is the point. In Renaissance Italy, they called them Gothic to mean barbarian, because they were conceived to be the people who destroyed Rome and therefore destroyed civilization. So Gothic was a huge insult. So there was Gothic architecture. What else was called Gothic? Gothic literature. That's where you start to get Gothic in terms of the macabre, isn't it?
Yes, and a sort of Byronesque sort of anti-hero, maybe.
Yeah.
The bad monks and women who always fainted and slightly lezzed up.
Yes. And what other forms of Gothic are there? Does Carpenter Gothic mean anything to you?
Carpenter Gothic?
Carpenter Gothic.
It was an interesting phase in their recording career. where... Because she was quite skinny anyway and she had the mascara. It looked good.
No, Carpenter Gothic...
Was it a death-obsessed Geppetto? That's American Gothic, isn't it?
That's right. Bye.
Now, I thought it was Norman Rockwell, but it isn't.
No, it's not Rockwell.
It's Grant somebody.
Grant is right. Grant Wood. And that is the actual building there in Eldon, Iowa.
Looks better in the painting, really, doesn't it?
Yes, a little dilapidated.
How have they got Gothic from that? What's Gothic about it?
That pointed ecclesiastical star window, it's a Gothic arch.
It's a bit of a lame effort, isn't it? Considering the trouble we went to over here.
Yeah, I know.
Americans think they can put a window like that in and call it Gothic. Lazy Gothic.
Lazy Gothic.
Half-assed Gothic.
Couldn't be bothered to do it properly Gothic. Mm.
Just so it fits under the roof, really, isn't it?
Yes.
Wasn't the guy in that painting his dentist?
You're absolutely right. It was Grant Wood's dentist. Points for Sue Perkins. That's pretty darn good. And the woman...
Is it Gail from Corrie? Pretty sure that's her.
Gail from Corrie.
Helen
Worth. Helen Worth, very nice woman.
She looks exactly like the character she plays. Very tall.
There is an incredible similarity.
That's very good. Anyway, so there are lots of things we call Gothic, and of course there are the young people who go about in black eyeliner and stuff.
Well, I like the fact that it makes me think that the Goths sacked Rome only after being nagged by their mum for a fortnight.
Oh, we have to. What was the lingua franca of ancient Rome?
Great balls of fire!
Dutch. I knew that's not going to come up.
Yeah, very good, yeah.
See, that's where you've got to think, Joe. You've got to think what they wouldn't put up.
Cheers, Sean. Be tender. Latin.
Oh!
Deliberately.
Yeah, I know.
At this point, she's going for the record.
It makes no sense. You might as well.
It's like shooting the moon when you play Hearts or one of those games.
Oh, it's such a brilliant game,
isn't it? Yeah.
What does lingua franca mean?
When people get together, it's a language that is commonly used as like everybody's second language, as it were.
Is it Greek?
Yes, it is Greek. It's the right answer. Greek is the language that people would use in Rome if they weren't.
So, can you tell me what the most successful textbook of all time is?
Is it the one that teaches you what LOL means and LMAO?
It probably is now, lol speak. Yeah. No, what's our theme for the day?
Geometry.
Oh, it's the...
Logarithms!
Logarithms, no.
No, not logarithms.
Do you want my eyes?
Stephen,
is it logarithms?
No. It's not logarithms. It's a jolly good guess.
Some sort of ancient geometrical textbook written probably by a Greek.
Cakes for beginners.
Euclid.
Euclid is the right answer, David Mitchell. Absolutely. Euclid. Euclid Stoica. Euclid's elements. And these propositions of Euclid are basically all about planes and the conical sections and all the forms of the circle and the square, the provable facts of geometry that are the basis of everything, really, all the physics that came afterwards, all the geometry.
He essentially turned up and said, this is why all the buildings have been falling down.
Yeah, well, there's an element to that, because engineering obviously owed a huge amount to it. Many mathematicians would believe his book is perhaps the most beautiful of all the mathematical books. We're looking at there, I think, one of the earliest editions. What's it say there? The most something philosopher. I can't actually read it.
Yeah, I'm brilliant with Latin. I just
no, it's written in English. The elements. But the names, you're right, the names are written in Greek there.
Yeah, that's what threw me. Yeah.
Elizabeth's court magician, John Dee, of Queen Elizabeth I. Have you heard of John Dee?
Mm.
Yeah, he was a very extraordinary man who worked as a spy. Now, there are points here, if you can tell me the cipher he used as a spy.
Did he use invisible ink?
No, he had a particular cipher, his call sign. And a writer many, many, many years later, who was extremely learned in the ways of the world, despite being thought of just as a thriller writer, used it for his own spy. Yes, so
007.
007, exactly. Yeah. It was John Dee's call sign.
I sense points.
You get points. In fact, you will have 7 points.
7 points?
Yeah, very good. Excellent. I could have 700 if you're backwards. That's too much.
I'm not going to speak again.
What is unfair about the prize money at Wimbledon? Yes.
They only give it to you if you're really, really good at tennis.
That is damnably unfair.
Nothing.
Really?
Not anymore.
No, it's very unfair.
Is this still unfair? Yes,
women get more money for playing than men.
Yeah. Oh, per set, you mean? You're talking women.
Yeah, men play a lot more tennis and get less money. Yeah, I'll show you how it goes. When it started in 1884, the ladies' champion won a 20-guinea silver flower basket. while the men got a 30-guinea gold trophy. By 2006, 625,000 for Amélie Mauresmo, who played 142 games, versus just £30,000 more for Roger Federer, who played 202 games. And the best women were earning more than the best men because their shorter matches allowed them to compete in both doubles tournaments as well as the singles. The rate per game told the story. 2005, the final eight women earned an average of £1,432 per game against the men's 993.
How much do they win now if they win?
It's equal for the first prize. The women's champion gets the same prize as the men's champion, but the men's champion plays a lot more tennis.
Yeah, but be fair, the women, they've got to come off and make the tea as well.
And women get more from sponsorship.
And also, half a million, that's not that much when you think 50% will go to tax, 15% will go to their agent, then they've got to buy all their balls, and they've got to buy the sticky stuff, the wrap around the racket. That's very expensive.
So do the
men. Feels so good to get a travel card. That's
so do the men.
They're left with about £1.50 after all that.
Anyway, now that male and female tennis players get the same prize money, it's arguably unfair to men who work harder and longer for less money overall.
When did slavery become a criminal offence in England?
I bet it was one of these odd little new Labour laws in about 1996,
7, 8. What an odd law to outlaw slavery. Is political correctness gone mad?
Odd in the sense that it's a bit late.
Yes, that's exactly right. It was 1807 when the slave trade was ended, and then finally in 1834, it was illegal anywhere in the British Empire to own a slave. It has never been illegal to have a slave in England until April 2010. I'm saying I could have had you as a slave legally.
You mean this series, I'm finally free?
Yes!
But you know what? I mean, one of those slaves who just goes back to the master. I don't know what to do. I work for you anyway, please.
One thing is that there are now estimated to be 27 million people held in, essentially, in bondage, in slavery on this planet.
But the show will be over soon. More, you can go.
Yeah.
Right now?
More than there ever were in the days of cotton picking and so on.
27 million?
27 million.
In the world?
That is the estimate. It's a pretty grim problem still, the slavery. The point is, it was never illegal in England because it was never recognised as a state of being. There were laws against kidnapping and abduction and false imprisonment and sexual trafficking and all the other things that we might associate with slavery. It was not illegal for one human to own another human, which it now is.
So this is a law that this isn't one of those laws where they thought, oh, that needs to clearing up. It's a loose end from history.
It kind of was. In 1967, there were a number of obsolete crimes that were taken care of. Barratry had been illegal right up to 1967, which is vexatious lawsuits.
Building of vexatious
lawsuits. Yeah, what they call a vexatious litigant, somebody just keeps carrying.
Dorothy Squires.
Yes.
Dorothy Squires, the singer Dorothy Squires, towards the end of her life when she did have a mania, but she was probably the last person to be done for vexatious litigant.
And if you kept prosecuting someone for it, you'd be prosecuting them
yourself.
Yeah, well, it's crazy. Anyway, there's scolding. Scolding was a crime in 1966, but not in 1967.
With hot water, you mean?
Not scolding. Scolding. Scolding.
That was a crime.
You! What time of the night do you call this, Eddie Izzard?
12.
Yes.
12:30.
Well, they give you a good scolding.
And that was illegal?
That was illegal.
Illegal. Yeah.
And now it's legal.
Eavesdropping was illegal. Challenging someone to a fight was also illegal until 1967.
What about going round and round and round about more than three times?
It certainly wouldn't have been a medieval law, would it?
Well, I don't know. And if you had a horse and cart, you had a couple of hours spare.
On a medieval roundabout.
On a medieval roundabout.
Yes. Anyway, there you are. Due to a quirk of English law, it only became a criminal offence to keep a slave in the year 2010. So you just missed it.
Who were the scallywags?
Does that ring a bell? The scallywags?
Not them, that's just a little suggestion.
Gin types.
I'm fairly sure it wasn't the SS.
Well, that's the odd thing.
It's the SS?
No.
You mean they were the scallywags?
What I'm saying is,
the cheekiest men in the war.
Despite the cheeky name, we're talking about something really dark and violent. Oh. That's why I'm going
snipers.
Well, no, what was the cutest, cuddliest, sweetest part of the British forces? Probably, if you think of
Virilin.
Yes, or Dad's Army, for example. The Home Guard, okay. Right? But there were plans afoot that if, and probably when, right, that's a man dressed as a woman doing a practice there, if and when the Germans invaded, there would be a guerrilla section of people who were not mainstream military.
I almost wish I had invaded. Yeah. There were
people in reserved occupations like...
Heads up, Prince.
Yeah.
Think about that picture. The baby's the best shot.
It's a truel. But clergymen and doctors were secretly trained, given money and supply dumps of ammunition and explosives and a gallon of rum in each one. And their job would be, when the Germans came, not only to shoot Germans, but there was a general view that Churchill would be killed or removed and someone like Lord Halifax would go in. And Michael Foote was one of these scallywags, as they were called. They were the secret auxiliary part of Dad's Army. And he and George Orwell and J.B. Priestley and others all were trained to assassinate anyone who collaborated with the Nazis. And there would be an underground resistance. And Michael Foote said, I would have killed Lord Halifax. I was quite prepared to, and I would have killed him. So they were pretty violent. It was not an easy, cosy thing.
quite... It's a good story,
it's
isn't
it? It's a terribly clever thing, though, isn't it? Because if somebody did come over and collaborate, anybody who might otherwise have caused trouble or ructions of a different kind would be automatically on the side of good.
Yes.
It's if you know what I mean.
That's the way... You're exactly right. It's that a group of radicals and left-wingers had an uneasy alliance with the military who trained them against the possibility of anybody who collaborated with Nazis.
That is a double-mind Jedi.
It is.
I think they're...
What I'm interested in is how Michael Foot's changed his image.
He has a little...
If he's worn that beautiful outfit at Armistice Day...
Why are so many great men short?
Are they really?
David, you've hit the nail on the head. Rem acu tetigisti, as they would say in Latin.
I'm sure they would.
Yeah.
it means nice one, son.
Yeah. That's absolutely right. In fact, Napoleon
was short, wasn't he?
No, he was above average height.
Everyone was short in those
wasn't
days.
Wasn't he? He was 5'6", which is taller than
he
is
now. He was 5'7", actually. Average height was about 5'6"-ish.
So it's just the British who decided he was short. Put him down a bit.
Yes. It was particularly a cartoonist called Gilray. When we were at war with Napoleon, there was a famous one of George III with a little Napoleon, based on Gulliver's Travels, like that. Ah. And he's actually saying, I cannot but conclude you to be one of the most pernicious little odious reptiles that nature ever suffered to crawl upon the surface of the earth.
It's a snappy one.
He was 3 inches taller than Nelson, for example. Nelson was 3 inches shorter than Napoleon. It's certainly true that...
Nelson was 5'4"?
Yeah.
Like Danny DeVito.
He was very, short chap.
No wonder they put him on such a big
so
column.
Is that kind of...
Yes, he's tall into Trafalgar Square.
Is that short man syndrome a kind of retrospective thing, then, that we've kind of invented more recently and then just gone back and said they're all short?
Yeah. Some of them were short, though. There's no question. I mean, Stalin was surprisingly short. He was only 5'5". Mussolini was 5'6". Franco was 5'4".
5'4"?
Yeah.
They are all short, Steve.
Well, no. Hit the 5'8". Idi Amin was 6'4".
Yeah, big
That's
fella.
My height. Mm. Fidel Castro, 6'1". Mao was 5'9", which is rather tall for a Chinese person.
Mm.
So...
But mostly they're not judged on their height, are they?
No. They're not. But all I...
We'll let that go.
Yeah. I'm saying, there seems to be historically no evidence that short people are more power-hungry, more tyrannical than people of average or tall stature.
Because you know how it came about, though, because it's just that one... It's probably the one thing that short people have got to cling on to. One day, they might be a dictator.
Well,
and we've just taken that away from them.
All this,
little hope.
All this not being able to reach things from shelves, one day will be made up for when I kill millions of people. I can stand on their bodies.
Yeah.
Reach the jam.
Yeah. Everybody knows somebody short in their life who's been particularly angry and abused his position of authority. And then you decide he's a bit like Hitler.
That's the point. You notice when a short man has a tantrum
and
says, oh, short man, Napoleon complex.
Tall man has a tantrum, you just leg it.
Exactly. Yeah. I have to say, I'm rather shocked by this. Heightism does exist. Short people are paid less on average than tall people. The disparity is comparable in magnitude to race and gender. A survey of Fortune 500 companies...
They should rise up.
Yeah. Hey. The chief executive officers of Fortune 500 companies, 90% are above average height. Which is astounding, really. And 30% of those are over 6'2". You're the tallest 4%.
Every now and again, a little short fella breaks through.
Yeah.
Oh, stop. Escapes, gets away.
Yeah, yeah.
But it is. I made it.
It is rather shocking that there is this disparity. And of course, we always notice the powerful, short, rich man with a young, tall wife is
billionaire Bernie Ecclestone. I've seen her with him. She's actually much taller than that. Above him.
Yeah, she's bending her knee there.
Yeah. I mean, he has to jump up to slap her on the bum. He can run through her legs.
And who's the couple on the left?
That's Carla Bruni and...
Sarkozy. But at least the women have both got handbags that their husbands can fit in.
No, No, there isn't really any evidence that dictators are shorter than the rest of us. The Napoleon complex is a bit.
Why are there no snakes in Ireland?
Sorry?
Oh, why are there no snakes?
Oh, I know
in
this
Ireland?
There's a reason that's related to the question I've been asking.
Something to do with the Ice Age.
Yeah, there were 20 periods of glaciation in Ireland. It was just coming, and they were withdrawing and coming, withdrawing all these glaciers.
So there's no snakes. You realise what you just said?
Yes.
Okay. You really can't help yourself.
I just am sorry, but. Snakes can't survive with frozen ground. Anyway, we were talking about glaciers, and they're found all over the world, and they're large, and they're blue, and they have calves, but unlike the surprisingly nippy blue whale, they can't manage much more than about 60 feet a day at top speed.